And it requires tremendous logistics. Almost magically tripling the workforce for IT support. And also the administrative side of things. So we have lost some time, but it is our intention to gain in whatever way we can. Without sacrificing the quality of the conference. So welcome again. I know you have had your first session over at the gymnasium. Yes. And help me to welcome the first presenter. Doctora Natalie Greaves.
Doctora Natalie Greaves.
Before she comes, I'll just introduce myself briefly. I am the coordinator for the public health program here at the Northern Caribbean University.
Yo soy la coordinadora para el programa de salud aquí en Northern Caribbean University.
Sonia Copeland.
Sonia Copeland.
I have worked over 30 years in the public health system here in Jamaica.
Yo he trabajado por más de 30 años en el sistema público o cuidado público, salud pública aquí en Jamaica.
Anytime I became too comfortable in one area of work.
Y si alguna vez me puse muy confortable o me sentí conforme en el área de trabajo de salud pública.
I was then moved to an even more challenging area.
Yo entonces era movida a otra área mucho más difícil.
So I was the director for health promotion and protection.
Yo era la directora para la promoción de salud.
Then I was moved to emergency and disaster management.
Y entonces fui movida para la, el puesto de emergencia y manejamiento de desastres.
And then I ended up in policy planning and development.
Y terminé en política o
desarrollo.
De planeamiento.
Sí.
De desarrollo.
Right. And now I have really found my true love, which is teaching public health.
Y ahora realmente he encontrado mi amor verdadero, que es salud pública.
Okay, so help me to welcome, please, warmly.
Así que ayúdeme a, por favor, bienvenir grandemente, calurosamente.
Natalie Greaves.
Natalie Greaves.
You just holding it, but it doesn't.
Yeah, okay.
Así que vamos a ver. Right, so we are very concerned about palliative care. It has been an area that has not received a lot of attention.
Así que nosotros estamos muy preocupados con el cuidado paliativo porque no es un área que ha recibido mucha atención.
And the resources have not always been there.
Y los recursos no siempre han estado ahí.
But undeniably,
pero no podemos negar.
Oh, sin duda, sí.
Sin duda, no
sí.
Podemos negar.
There is an epidemic of the chronic diseases.
Hay una epidemia de las enfermedades crónicas.
And we are now hurrying to provide palliative care, rehabilitative care.
Y ahora nosotros nos estamos apurando en dar cuidado rehabilitativo, cuidado paliativo.
And so, we're going to be hearing from Dr. Greaves, a study that she did right here in the Caribbean.
Y nosotros vamos a escuchar de Dr. Greaves un estudio que ella hizo aquí en el Caribe.
And she wants us to think about our respective role in palliative care.
Y ella quiere que nosotros pensemos en nuestro rol, en nuestro papel en el cuidado paliativo.
Gracias. Okay, so this morning I'm actually not going to be presenting on a study. It's really reflections.
Así que esta mañana no voy a presentar específicamente un estudio, sino una reflexión.
Reflections, I've been asked to share reflections on palliative care.
Así que es una reflexión en cuidado paliativo.
And palliative care as it relates to lessons that we can learn from the Caribbean. In the interest of time and making sure that we all can have the opportunity to share, Dr. Copeland and I have agreed that I will condense my presentation.
Okay?
Right. Initially, it was supposed to be 45 minutes. But we will spend 25 minutes learning together. Now, as the keynote, we usually have very long bios. I invite you to read it so that we can just start. Fantastic. Okay. Okay, so they've said un momento, so I know that's 1 minute more. So we will start. So in our discussion today, I'm going to seek to share with you 4 key points. We're going to look at the definition of palliative care as per the World Health Organization. However, we are going to critically analyze that definition. Then we are going to look at the debates around the definition. We're going to establish the need for palliative care. And then I want us to think about what we can do in terms of education, care provision, advocacy, and collaborations. Yes? Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Alrighty. So since we've started setting that framework, this is just what I just said in terms of the objectives. The objectives of the session, okay? So we're going to go to the next slide. Yep. So as it relates to the World Health Organization definition, thank you. Fantastic. The definition that we use now is a 2002 definition. The definition before that was the 1990 definition. And this year we expect the definition to change. Okay? So in the transition over time,
así que en la transición durante ese tiempo,
from 1990
to 2002
to 2019,
there are some significant
things to note. Firstly, in
1990,
the definition was housed around providing palliative care. For persons with a diagnosis of cancer, primarily cancer. The definition that we use now, that we should all be very familiar with, has five cardinal features. One, palliative care is an approach to care. It can be adapted to suit the needs of the individual populations. The emphasis or the goal of care is improvement of quality of life.
Es el desarrollo de la cualidad de vida.
Right. The clientele is dual. It's not just for the patient, but it's for the patient and their family members.
No solo por el paciente mismo, sino para el paciente y su familia.
And as we said before,
y como dije antes,
it's applicable from the start of the disease. Most persons think of palliative care at the end. But the true definition, we know that persons do better, have a better quality of life when palliative care starts with at the time when they receive their diagnosis. Unfortunately, in the Caribbean and many countries of Latin America, many persons are still receiving that diagnosis at a very advanced stage. So for us in Latin America and the Caribbean, palliative care tends to focus on the end of life. But it doesn't end with the patient or unfortunately the death of a patient. Palliative care seeks to support the family even in the period of bereavement. Right. So, we all in this room may be very familiar with the 1948 definition of health. Exactamente. Where we think about health as a holistic construct. So we think about social well-being, physical well-being, emotional well-being. But in that 1948 definition, spiritual health is not represented. However, in 1984, right, the World Health Organization recognizes or recognized
that there is a role for the spiritual dimension in the care of persons. And this is very important also in palliative care. So as it relates to a modern history, I want us to leave here with a clear construct, a clear understanding of where we were, where we are now, and where we're going as it relates to palliative care. So the watershed moment, or the line that we use as a starting point, or a division, is 1967. So we talk about before 1967, and we talk about after 1967. So why is 1967 important? So in 1967 was the opening of the first modern hospice. Okay, so the name of the hospice was St. Christopher's Hospice in Sydenham in London. And the person credited with that is Dame Cicely Saunders. Cicely Saunders. So before 1967, the reality is we have always been caring for persons who have been very ill. And we've always been caring for persons right until the end of their life. However, you can argue that between 1900 and 1967, there was a change in the way how physicians, nurses, how persons cared for people who were dying. Yeah, because the thinking is there was what we will call a medicalization. More chemotherapies, more radiation, more new surgical techniques. And advance in technology, but a decrease in the ability to care. A loss of the identity of the individual. A loss in dignity. A loss in the ability to address pain and suffering. Therefore, around the time of 1967, there was an uprising of sorts, a rebellion, resulting in the birth of the modern hospice movement. And what we now call palliative care. So these are some important dates, and I will make the entire presentation available. But to highlight a few very important things that have happened. So we have the World Health Organization becoming very interested in the care of persons who are dying, and more importantly, the management of pain in those persons. So in 1982, we have cancer pain management meetings. We have pain relief guides. And this is something that we take for granted now. But they did not always exist. Importantly, in 2000, we have the formation of the Latin American Association of Palliative Care. And in 2011, we have the formation of palliative care associations in the Caribbean. So we have the Palliative Care Association of Jamaica, Palliative Care Society of Trinidad and Tobago, and the Palliative Care Association of Barbados. So why do we need palliative care in Latin America and the Caribbean? In particularly focusing on the Caribbean, why do we need it? And I want to argue with you that we need it, one, from the perspective of individual rights. We all have the right to life, but we all have the right to dignity in life, included in those very difficult periods where life might be coming to its end. It's part of the fundamental right to health. Also, all of our countries in the Caribbean and all of the countries in Latin America as well are signatory, have signed WHA Resolution 67.19. A resolution in 2014, saying that they will provide palliative care to the citizens of their country in the context of non-communicable diseases. Why non-communicable diseases? Because we have a problem in our region with hypertension, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, cancer, and all of these diseases have trajectories or pathways that can lead to organ failure and death. And it is very important that we provide care consistently to our populations, because the number of persons needing this care is increasing dramatically. Not slowing down. Right, okay. So for for cardiac disease, heart failure, diabetes,
associated with renal failure?
Okay,
don't worry. And cancers, we are all familiar with the unfortunate statistics. Which show that the incidence and mortality of cancer in our region, including in pediatric populations, is increasing. So this is a relatively old slide. But the new global burden of disease report, global burden of disease, it's no different. Yeah? In most of the English-speaking Caribbean,
in most 70%
of deaths, in particular premature deaths, are caused by NCDs, non-communicable diseases. And they will all need palliative care during the last year of life. So the question is, we know that we need this thing. Not only from the non-communicable diseases aspect, but also when we consider how communicable diseases, some communicable diseases are changing. For example, HIV/AIDS. Persons are living longer, and they're also having complications associated with highly active antiretroviral treatments, complications with the treatments that they receive. For example, high blood cholesterol levels, diabetes, and also cross-reactivity with tuberculosis. Yes. Okay. So we know we need it. But how do we provide it? How do we provide it in the context of health systems that don't have enough money, that don't have enough human resources, may not have the education capacity to train the human resources? What can we do? What lessons can we learn? Are there any successes? There are successes. Yes. And I want to share those with you. Firstly, we have to consider what our health systems can afford. In the context of who receives care and where is care provided. In systems where we cannot provide care from the point of diagnosis, countries can seriously think about providing care in the critical period. So although the definition says that palliative care starts from the point of diagnosis, decisions may need to be made to facilitate care in the most critical periods.
Yeah.
So, as it relates to expanding care provision, how do we provide care? These are successful models thus far in the Caribbean. Okay. In Cayman Islands, they have been able to have a standalone hospice, a building for, yeah, not attached to a hospital.
Okay, es un hospital particular.
Yeah, yeah. And in Barbados, which may be of relevance to NCU, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has been funding the first palliative care clinic. For the past 9 years. Through the National Association, care is also provided in Barbados, in patients' homes. So multidisciplinary teams involving nurses, doctors, social workers visit patients in their homes to provide care. And I highlight this because not everything can be funded by government. There's a role for non-governmental organizations, including faith-based organizations. In Trinidad, there are a number of hospices. Importantly, their system has worked because of government support. So we see where there can be synergies between governments in terms of providing buildings, in addition to funding for staff. And as we wind down, because I got the signal to lie down, I want us to focus on education. There are few institutions in the Caribbean offering palliative care education. And the way that we have galvanized education and training is through short courses at universities so far. And you might recognize this logo, which is USC. Yes? And USC was very instrumental in facilitating training. With relationships with Canadian trainers. The University of the West Indies has also leveraged international support to facilitate short courses, which rapidly provide nurses, doctors, pharmacists, social workers, nursing home owners, with the skills needed to provide care. In addition, alliances with international organizations
las,
has been able to bring training to the region in specialty areas. For example, pain management,
and
including opiate availability and use of morphine. Many of our countries do not have enough medications to address pain adequately or pathways to safely manage the drugs in the country. And through international support, we've been able to assist countries with the development of guidelines. Now, in the University of the West Indies, palliative care, medical students are now exposed to palliative care. So in the fourth year, part of their medical school curriculum, they are able to have day attachments to palliative care, places providing palliative care. And I would hope that NCU would think about ways in which to incorporate palliative care into their curriculum. So right now, as it relates to research, palliative care will not move forward unless there is education, there's care provision, and there's also research. Yeah, research. Investigate. Care provision.
Hasta que no haya cuidado,
education.
De la salud,
and investigation.
Research.
Right. And we've been very fortunate to have support from National Institutes of Health.
Así que muy
to facilitate training.
Ayuda de esas
Development of national guidelines.
El desarrollo de las, de los esquemas, nacionales.
And research opportunities.
Y algunas oportunidades de investigación sobre esa área.
And I'm going to skip forward this just so that I can highlight someone from your school. So every February 4th
Así que cada febrero, cada 4 de febrero.
Is World Cancer Day. So this morning you got Sabbath creation day to remember, October 26th. I'm giving you World Cancer Day, which is February 4th. If you are not already doing something on your campus to facilitate awareness, regarding cancer and palliative care, I encourage you to do so. One of your director of research, Dr. Jackie Vigilance, and my colleague Heather Harewood, we were able to conduct research related to palliative care and cancer and breast cancer patients in Barbados. And in conjunction with the Jamaica Cancer Research Institute,
y en relación con la institución jamaicana de investigación del cáncer,
at UE Mona,
en UE Mona,
we hope to partner with NCU
nosotros esperamos que nosotros
in replicating
hagamos,
this study.
Hagamos una relación con NCU y nosotros podamos replicar esos estudios.
For the sole purpose
para el único propósito.
Of improving the lives of women with cancer in Jamaica. I need to stop now to give other persons the opportunity to ask questions. And I really want to encourage you to let's use the remaining 5 to 10 minutes to ask as many questions as you want regarding palliative care and cancer. Thank you. Yes. Okay, so as it relates to caregiver resilience,
así que en lo que se refiere al síndrome del cuidador,
right now,
ahora mismo,
we are designing a study
nosotros estamos diseñando un estudio
on health professionals
en los profesionales de la salud.
In Barbados, unfortunately, not Jamaica,
unfortunadamente, no.
But it's focused on prostate cancer. Because in Barbados, prostate cancer is the number one in terms of highest incidence, highest mortality. So we are looking now at health professionals, urologists, oncologists, assessing their knowledge, but also the emotional impact. Yeah, so that's where we are now. But if you are interested in, I'm very open to share methodology. Absolutely. Yes. Right. So that's a very good question. And I think the first thing to recognize is that the spiritual dimension, you have the opportunity to address it in persons of varying faith. And persons of no faith. The construct is one of respect. Yeah, care.
Incluyen respeto, cuidado,
and love.
Y amor.
Yeah? Not necessarily one of conversion.
No necesariamente conversión.
Yeah? At the faith-based clinic,
en la clínica religiosa,
Seventh-day Adventist,
en la
there are two pastors that assist families with coping as well as patients. During the illness and after. In addition, there is the opportunity for the physicians, the nurses, etc., to interact with health, with spiritual advisors. Of their patients,
de sus pacientes,
who may be of different faiths. Now, anecdotally, what we have noticed,
ahora, lo que nosotros hemos notado,
And this bears out in existing evidence. That persons who have tapped into the spiritual domain are more resilient. So in terms of a pathway, it would be very important for churches to be open to providing this form of care, engaging with families, but also persons of other faiths, and being part of palliative care teams where they can be.
Entonces no podemos estar aquí mucho rato. Ella no se va a evaporar. Ella va a estar aquí. Así que yo le digo que usted puede hablar con ella. Es importante la definición que usted ha dicho, que ellos han dejado fuera del cuidado paliativo.
Right.
Así que muchas personas usan esa definición de cuidado paliativo.
Yeah, I want to clarify this for everyone. It's very important. In the WHO 1948 definition of health, spirituality is not mentioned. In 1984, the dimension is recognized. It's not in the definition, but it's recognized. In 2002, definition of palliative care, the spiritual domain is in the definition. So it is seen as important. Muy importante.
I wish to thank you, Doctor, for setting the stage for the other presentations. Because the recognition from the very top at the World Health Organization has now made it easier for us to integrate mind, body, and spirit in our holistic approach. Okay, so that was the good news. The bad news is that I'm going to have to shave some more time off your presentations, and I'm sure you can understand, because we are translating simultaneously.
Vamos a cortar las presentaciones, ¿verdad? Vamos a hacer el tiempo más corto.
Yes, I'm very happy that we are providing translation.
Nosotros estamos muy felices de que podemos proveer traducción.
But it does. Yeah, it takes time. Yes. But I love the translation. So remember, we can engage and continue the discussions after. So, presenters, wear your seat possible. We're going to ask you to condense your presentations. And now we're going to be looking at, you know, this one jumped out at me.
A
longitudinal analysis of dengue, in Jamaica over the period 2004 to 2017. Help me to welcome. Yes, Janisha Bryan Thomas, medical technologist.
Médico de la tecnología.
Ajá. Bueno. Ajá. Así que tú puedes
sentar. Ah, gracias.
Yeah, sí, sí. So this is just really for the camera, so you have to really project. Momentico. The person at the back aren't hearing very well, and so it would probably just take a minute to move this forward and to move her forward if we get her.
Good morning, everyone.
Buenos días a todos.
So I'm told that I don't have as much time, so I'm going to cut the presentation in half.
Voy a cortarla a la mitad.
So the topic that is projected,
bueno, el tema que está proyectado,
and I'm going to be asking the Spanish speaking people
y le voy a pedir a las personas que hablan español,
to first tell us what they see.
Que nos digan primeramente qué es lo que ven.
Yes, so we are going to be talking about a particular type of mosquito.
Sí, nosotros vamos a estar hablando sobre un tipo de mosquito particular.
The dengue mosquito.
El mosquito del dengue.
And the period between 2004 to 2017. And what took place during that period with this particular mosquito. This research was conducted by Janisha Bryan Thomas, Antoinette Parchment, and Jalene Campbell. Right. So, dengue fever is caused by the Aedes aegypti. Mosquito that is considered to be vector-borne.
Este mosquito es considerado un vector.
Right. In Jamaica, we tend to have our rainy seasons
en Jamaica tenemos el periodo de lluvia
during May to September.
Desde mayo a septiembre.
The research, therefore, is geared at finding out whether or not there is a link. Right, between the rainy season's humidity and the increase in dengue cases in Jamaica. Right. Therefore, it's a retrospective analysis looking at that period. The intent or the objective is to provide documented evidence
es proveer información documental
specific to the Jamaican population
específicamente para la población jamaicana
regarding the relationship, if any,
que se refiere a la relación
to climatic variations
que se refiere a la relación de cambios climáticos
to dengue. How will this information help us? Will it?
¿Cómo esta información nos ayudaría?
Let me see the hands of those who think this information might help.
Quisiera ver las manos de aquellos que piensan que esta información nos va a ayudar.
Very good. Very good. The information will assist in mitigating the increased incidence.
Esta información nos va a ayudar a reducir el crecimiento del dengue.
of dengue, thereby reducing the mortality rate. In the population. Fewer mosquitoes will reduce in fewer outbreaks. General problem, the large number of dengue cases in Jamaica is a matter of grave concern. Now, the study took into consideration the entire population or the entire island of Jamaica. Information was gathered from the Ministry of Health, the surveillance unit. Or Statistical Institute. Statin, and the ODPEM. So dengue, because of the increase in dengue cases and the symptoms that we're seeing, it was clear that a study that speaks to our Jamaican population and this particular relationship was needed. Just to reiterate, repeat. The purpose of the study is to highlight the burden of dengue outbreak on the Jamaican population. Right. So I'm moving quickly into our results because that's the sweet part. Okay, so I need my pointer because in 2004, we saw that there were 50 cases that were notified. While only 48 cases were officially confirmed to be positive for dengue. As you look at the information projected, you'll realize that there are different low sections, and then there's a spike. And it continues right down until 2017. The fluctuation. Why, you may ask? We did not just look at the raw data given to us by the Ministry of Health, but we compared the data. With the annual rainfall and humidity that was reported. It is clear that while we have a lot of notified or suspected cases, after our PCR has been done, the number dramatically decreases. the more our population is informed about what needs to be done to prevent dengue, the less positive dengue cases are confirmed. Take, for instance, in 2017, 5,500 notified cases came in. 2007. But only 1,521 were truly positive for dengue. The 5,500 cases were those cases that came in as persons who were thought to really be positive for dengue. But after PCR was done, only 1,521. We know that dengue, when a person has the general flu-like symptoms around these times, many persons begin to think of dengue. Or perhaps chikungunya. Or Zika V. Zika. But here we are seeing that with increased testing, we are able to pinpoint the correct numbers. Here, we have our chart that gives us an analysis of the rainfall data from 2004, going right back to 2014. I'd like for us, though, to analyze this particular slide. In 2004, we had Charlie and Ivan. For 2004, only 48 confirmed cases having a Category 3 hurricane. After having a Category 3 hurricane, we only had 48 cases. But in 2007, with only Dean, with only Hurricane Dean, we had 1,521 cases. Can we then confirm or conclude that there is a link? In 1998, there's a study that was done in Thailand that found a link that we did not find. There's another study in 2010 that found that there was also a link. Based on our preliminary study for this research, we are not seeing that link. I'm going to go back to something I think you definitely need to look at. With my 30 seconds. So, we are seeing fluctuations whether or not there's a hurricane, whether or not we have a lot of rainfall. In 2007, rainfall was 2,139 cubic meters. And for that year, we had the highest dengue cases. However, when we had Dennis, Emily, and Wilma in 2005, with the year with the highest rainfall, 2,412, we had a very small number of confirmed cases. Then we look way down to 2017. What is the difference? What made the difference here? Education. Is it rainfall? No, it's education. So we say that together, education. And there is no more time beyond this. So, to prevent dengue here, what we have, one of two things. Well, two things. Almost every primary, secondary school here, we have our
we've been having wonderful presentations so far, you will agree.
Hemos tenido presentaciones maravillosas. ¿Podemos estar de acuerdo con eso?
Yes, and this topic here of vector-borne diseases.
Y este tema aquí de enfermedades del dengue
is showing that we have a lot of work to do.
Esto nos demuestra que tenemos mucho trabajo que hacer.
Our next presenter
nuestro próximo presentador
is Professor of Anthropology,
es una profesora de antropología,
Dr. Suzanne Chan,
la doctora Suzanne Chan,
and she's a director of research and innovation.
Y ella es la directora de investigación e innovación.
And she's from the University of the Southern Caribbean, Trinidad.
Y ella es de la Universidad del Suroeste de Trinidad.
Help me to welcome her.
A very good afternoon to each and every one of you.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you for this opportunity.
Gracias por esta oportunidad.
Oh, which one?
This is just scroll.
This one to go. Yes, so we are moving from the All right, so it's an ongoing study. And we are doing it inside the valley, which is close to USC. And we are doing it within the church, within the churches of Seventh-day Adventists. So within the valley, close to USC, we have about 4 Adventist churches right there. Yeah, sorry, I couldn't bring a picture of the beautiful valley scene that we have there. Yes, but people have their own experiences with their illness and sicknesses. Right, so health-seeking behavior. In this presentation, it's a process. To responding, people's responding to illnesses. It is very dynamic and involves multiple steps. And we are seeing a pattern emerging, pattern coming out, that people are engaging a network of family members, friends, and church members and experts. In moving towards making decisions about their health and well-being. Okay, I'll just skip that one because health-seeking behavior is defined here. Yeah. It's how, from the time a person identifies the symptoms or signs of ill health, till he finds, he or she finds solutions to the problem and experiencing healing or cure from that illness. Right, there are many factors that are responsible for this health-seeking behavior. So there are social cultural factors that includes family, the cultural beliefs and practices. Then we say, employed or not employed. And I don't have it here on the slide, but there are 3 A's that people are concerned about when they are looking for seeking help for health or illnesses. And we are familiar in the public health sector. It is very prevalent in the health sector when people are looking for healthcare services. Yeah. So the 4A is availability of healthcare. If it is available or not. Yeah, so if it is available, is it accessible or not? And if it is accessible, whether it is acceptable by the culture or not? Oh, I missed one. If it is there, if it is available, is it affordable or not? And the health practitioners also talk about the 5th A, and that is accommodation. Whether it's different from being acceptable, whether it can be accommodated within their cultural framework or not. Yes, so that is that we cover the healthcare facilities, we covered that, and then, yeah. The last one over here, I'm sorry, it got somewhat erased, but it was about personal relationship with God. And these factors were also seen while we were interviewing the participants. It was a phenomenological study Oh, it was an interviews that we took from the 20 participants.
Okay, entonces nosotros hicimos entrevistas a 20 participantes.
Yes, because it is qualitative, we took a small sample.
Como esto era cualitativo, tuvimos una muestra pequeña.
And we spent some time talking with them.
Y pasamos un tiempo hablando con ellos.
And we interviewed husband-wife team.
Y tuvimos una buena entrevista.
In some cases. And in others, we just interviewed whoever was available. Right. A framework that we were also applying to this study was Kleinman's explanatory model. Explaining how they explain about their health and disease. And it is coming out that there is a model that patients use to explain their disease. And there's a model that doctors use to explain the patient's disease condition. So the patients give their own cultural explanation about their ill health. I'll just give an example for one person whom we are interviewing.
Yo solamente tengo un ejemplo de una persona que fue entrevistada.
He was suffering from hernia.
Ella tenía una hernia.
Yes, and so he was, I didn't understand because I'm not a, I do live in Trinidad, but I don't understand a lot of local way they explain. So I found it very interesting. So he said his stomach got locked.
Ella dijo que tenía el estómago cerrado.
Yeah, locked, and then it locked within the impression. The stomach got locked and locked with the impression. So I had to ask one of my colleagues who's right here, Dr. Mitchell. What did that mean exactly? Well, so she said the stomach locking means it was tightening. There was a tightening of the muscles or the pain. The locking was referring to the pain.
Okay. Eso significaba que tenía como que el estómago apretado, que tenía
yes, intense pain. And the impression was pressing down. Something was pressing down.
Y la impresión era que algo como que le estaba presionando el estómago.
Right. So that is the explanation the patients give about their ill health condition. And if the doctor who's attending to these cases are not from the same culture to understand their language, so there'll be gap in the patient explanation and the doctor's understanding of that explanation. And that have implications on the delivery of the healthcare system to the patient. Right, so we were studying, exploring ways as to how individuals' health-seeking behavior was integrated within the church community. Right, time is almost up, but But it was interesting to see that when they were suffering from acute illnesses, acute condition. Like pain, fever, they immediately rushed to the doctor. In this case was their family doctor. But when it was a chronic condition, they ignored it for a while, tried home remedies, alternative medicine, didn't find relief, ended with the hospital, took the medical care,
obtienen el cuidado médico,
came back home,
van de regreso a casa,
did their own research,
hacen su propia investigación,
never went back again,
y nunca van de regreso,
treated themselves,
y luego se tratan ellos mismos,
and doing good.
Well,
the doctors will not agree with me. But this is what cultural explanation and health-seeking behavior is working. Right, and some of these were the conditions that they were treating themselves. But they visited the specialist from time to time. They made sure. To make sure they are going in the right directions and the vital statistics are down. Right. Right, we said about that. Okay. Okay, so the sources of information we did mention was family, network of friends, church members. And being a Seventh-day Adventist, they kept referring to one book that they had been, you know, following. Yeah, Back to Eden. Yes, so they were, you know, most of them were, you know, but some were not, you know, reading that book, but they found their own information. Well, one person said that the person did not need any advice from the church members, but they were always offering advices. Unsolicited. Yes, and this person was in a pain for, is still in pain for past 38 years. And his church members, friends, anybody who meets him gives him advice on how to do pain management. They have given him recipes of home remedies. So he begins one remedy, does not complete it. And the pain comes back. Yes, so that is the pattern that goes on with this person. But a lot of people said personal relationship with God, prayer and Holy Spirit, searching the scriptures when they were in serious conditions, helped them out. And just to share about the perceptions that they had about cure and healing is so important to know from patients or the people's perspective. And one of them expressed, at least two of them said, doctors do not hold the same health views as yours. They make you feel functional and not necessarily better. Right, and then there were other factors, however, was responsible for those doctors being mostly consulted. Their personality, their attitude towards the disease or illness, if they were from the same ethnicity or nationality, if they integrated alternative or home remedies, especially for lifestyle diseases, like diabetes or blood pressure, where diet and exercises were involved. Right, so proposed model is when we integrate patient's explanation doctor's explanation, but we are missing a third component which Kleinman did not include, is including the community members' explanatory models. Because the person is experiencing his ill health within a setup, a community setup, or a family setup. So we need to take their explanatory model into consideration.
Porque los pacientes están afrontando una enfermedad dentro de los ámbitos de la familia, de los amigos, y necesitamos tener su explicación.
In able to deliver them the better healthcare services. Right, so our closing thought is,
y ahora para cerrar,
is found in Proverbs. All these texts, you can read them.
Mm-hmm. Ahora para cerrar, ustedes pueden buscar en su Biblia,
because one of them very aptly pointed out that in the there's wisdom in the multitude of counselors. But those counselors should be well experienced or have an expertise in the area. Thank you very much.
So we'll take questions after the other presenters. Yes. So we will not be taking questions now, but at the end of the next two presenters. We will now have a presentation on
ahora tendremos una presentación
salvation and health in the book of Luke.
Ahora tendremos una presentación basada en la salvación y la salud en el libro de Lucas.
Implications for meeting the human need for wholeness.
Y las implicaciones en alcanzar las necesidades humanas para el bienestar de ellos.
We welcome Dr. Michael Lupe.
Bueno, le damos la bienvenida al Dr. Michael
Olupe. And would you believe that I consulted with him just a while ago about the proper pronunciation? I did not want to.
Pueden imaginar que yo hace un minuto consulté con él sobre la pronunciación de su nombre.
I did not want to slaughter his name.
Yo no quería faltarle respeto a su nombre.
Please help me to welcome
Dr. Michael.
I like to thank my friends who are here to support me. And go straight to the point. Well, when we talk about salvation and health, they sound like opposites. We limit salvation to the spiritual, and we talk about health in the physical. But the aim of this is to see the relationship between the two, especially in the Gospel of Luke. As Christians, we believe that there are four Gospels. In case you didn't know, there are many other Gospels. They are called apocryphal Gospels. But we recognize four as inspired. Luke is the third of the four. I want to highlight a few other things about Luke. He is a companion of Paul. And we find that in some verses. Philemon 1:24. 2 Timothy 4:11. but very, very significant for this study is that Luke is described as a beloved physician. In Colossians 4:14. And so Luke's gospel is filled with medical terms as it relates to diseases and cure. I wasn't expecting to be translated. but so I was planning to just go quickly through them, but let's see what we can do here. I want to highlight some Greek words that are connected to English. All right, the first one is autoptai, translated eyewitnesses. And it's the root word for the English autopsy, which is a medical term. We have the word iatre. And interestingly, the suffix for the term for specialists, pediatric, the iatric at the end is the Greek word for physician. We have thromboi. And interestingly, Luke is the only gospel writer who points out that in Gethsemane, where Jesus prayed, blood came out from his skin. And so in describing that process, he uses the Greek word thromboi. And that's where we get the English word for thrombosis, or a blood clot. Blood clot. All right, the last one is a little challenging. It's bradycardia, which is translated slow of heart. After Jesus' resurrection, he tells his disciples that they are foolish and slow of heart to believe what the prophets have said. Well, I was interested to find out that there's actually an English word bradycardia, which describes an abnormally slow heart. All right, so slow. All right, bless the Lord. All right, the Holy Spirit is helping with the translation. All right, so the point is that Luke is using medical terms in his gospel. Some of the key words for salvation in the Greek are sozo and soteria. The heart of this presentation is that these words have double meaning. They refer to both physical healing and spiritual healing. And so in Luke, when Jesus heals physically, it is an illustration of what he can do spiritually. All right. It also captures the holistic picture that Dr. Natalie talked about earlier. One One of my favorite illustrations of this in Luke is the woman with the issue of blood. So physically, she's bleeding. Financially, she's spending money on doctors. Socially, she's declared unclean. Mentally, she's worried about her condition. And spiritually, she cannot worship. She cannot go to church. And in those days, they believed that if you're sick, you're punished by God. So when Jesus healed her, he made her whole. He healed her in every way. All right? And so that's the picture of salvation in Luke. This shows that the salvation Jesus offers brings restoration to the whole person. And shows that God is interested in every aspect of the human life. I'm going to rush through all these. And go to the World Health Organization's 1948 definition, showing that health is not limited to the physical, but affects every dimension. So the bottom line of this presentation is that while the church may present salvation as spiritual, we need to present it from a holistic perspective. And this is what Luke's gospel presents to us. And I'm happy that the church in Jamaica just finished a holistic approach. All right, this is the final part of the presentation. It's interesting that science shows that there is a relationship between the different dimensions. All right, and I had a few, but I don't have the time to present them. All right, some experiments of how belief actually affects your body, the health. This doctor treated pregnant women who were vomiting. And he gave them medication that would make them vomit even more. But then he told them that the medicine would reduce the vomiting. And that's exactly what happened. Because they believed it, it worked. even though chemically, it was supposed to produce more vomiting. So it shows a relationship between the mind and the body. Norman Cousins suffered a disease that caused him a lot of pain. But he discovered that laughing for 10 minutes reduced his pain. And so emotionally, if you're good in the mind, it can affect the body positive. And this was the beginning of laughter therapy. And of course, spiritually, those who take religion seriously enjoy better health benefits. So to go straight to the point, This also supports the fact that when God created man in Genesis, he made him a whole being. This supports the biblical concept that there is no soul in the body, but that the soul is a person, an indivisible unit. And so when we minister to people, like Jesus did, we need to minister to them from a holistic perspective. So our churches need to teach people how to take care of their mental health. Teach people how to take care of their relationships and even their finances. That is essentially what this presentation is about. And so I want to say thank you for listening.
Okay, so let's thank again Dr. Michael. He did extra special because it is not easy to hold your attention at lunchtime. Okay, so we have two more presentations.
Yes.
Oh, we have a question, but we're going to take the questions if we can. Yeah,
sí,
that's
ver,
what you're asking?
Ver, la pregunta.
Okay, all righty. Okay, and I am just really asking the presenters if they find it possible to condense to do so.
Así que realmente because les pidiendo a los presentadores que si pueden condensarla, que lo hagan.
Yes, because I think the bus is here.
Porque la guagua está aquí.
To take you to the other side of the campus.
Para llevarlos al otro lugar del campus.
Our next presenter,
nuestro próximo presentador,
right, is Dr. Ciro Ernesto Redondo Mendoza.
Es el Dr. Ciro Ernesto Redondo Mendoza.
Right, I want to practice my Spanish too. And he will be presenting the character of God
el carácter de Dios
and mental health.
Y la salud mental.
It is really instructive how we have just positioned these presentations.
Pusimos esta presentación en orden.
Okay. Please welcome.
Por favor, vamos a bienvenir al doctor.
Muy buenas tardes ya. Quiero decirles que esta investigación fue desarrollada por el doctor Ciro Redondo y por un servidor, Luis Enrique Rivero. Luis, yes. El doctor Ciro Redondo no pudo venir, pero dado de que yo soy también co-investigador, haré la presentación en nombre de los dos. Luis Enrique. Okay. Hay varios autores que señalan que la religión influye negativamente en la salud mental. Dicen que la religión es causa de sentimientos de culpa, de odio a sí mismo, de complejo de inferioridad, y la señalan como causante de muchos trastornos mentales. No obstante, hay otros autores y otras investigaciones que muestran una relación positiva entre la religión y la salud mental. El doctor Redondo y yo nos hemos dedicado a investigar últimamente sobre la línea de investigación relacionada con la psicología de la religión. Y de la psicología de la religión ha surgido la psicología pastoral. Para Restrepo y Jaramillo, salud mental es la capacidad del sujeto para adaptarse racionalmente a las demandas internas y externas. Debemos ver la salud mental como un espectro entre lo positivo, que es un estado completo de bienestar, y un polo negativo que va más allá que la ausencia de trastornos mentales. Muy bien, en nuestra investigación nos propusimos ver si había relación entre lo que las personas creen de Dios, entre su nivel de confianza en Dios y la salud mental. Tomamos una población cristiana de diferentes confesiones religiosas para hacer este estudio. Y la metodología que se usó fue aplicar un instrumento donde estaba ya un instrumento validado sobre salud mental y también otro instrumento sobre la confianza en Dios. Fue una investigación de enfoque cuantitativo, con nivel descriptivo y de alcance transversal. Bien, afortunadamente esta población ratificó que la religión sí contribuye a la salud mental. Aunque no deja de haber personas con algunos trastornos mentales o con problemas de salud mental, ansiedad, depresión y otros trastornos, esta población en particular evidencia una alta presencia de salud mental, alta presencia de salud mental, y también relacionada con una alta confianza en Dios. Pensamos que iba a haber una variación entre las personas que tenían más años en la iglesia y los que tenían pocos años. Pero la verdad es que no hubo una diferencia significativa. Quizá el mayor aporte de esta investigación es avanzar en una línea empírica de descripción de realidades que permiten visibilizar algunas concepciones teóricas de estudios que han precedido para comprender la complejidad del fenómeno religioso en la vida de los seres humanos. Concluyo con el siguiente pensamiento del Ministerio de Curación de la señora White. Tradúcelo de una vez.
My peace I give unto you. This peace is not yet. Yes. Amen. Amen.
Sí.
It doesn't come from the person, it's a gift from God.
Así que de la palabra de Dios, ninguna persona verdaderamente cristiana. La religión debiera ser una causante de trastornos mentales o de enfermedades psicopatológicas. Porque lo que produce la presencia de Dios en la vida de una persona no es perturbación, confusión, autodestrucción, sino paz. Y esa paz no se puede conseguir fuera de él. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please take a seat. Yes, okay. I made a note to share with the organizers that I'm not a magician. But with your help, we were able to make up time as best as we could. Yes. And in the next 10 minutes, we will have to conclude. We have left the best for last.
Nosotros hemos dejado lo mejor para ti.
Development and validation,
el desarrollo y la validación
of a spiritual health instrument.
De un instrumento espiritual, en salud.
And so we have several contributors to this study.
Muchos contribuidores a este estudio.
And who do we have? Is it Dr. Victor? Right.
Okay, please,
and give us your best applause.
So, tenemos Carlos Marcelo Moroni, Víctor Andrés Kornechuk, Jaime Rodríguez Gómez y Alberto Valderrama.
Right. So, he is closing this grand session. Give him a very hearty applause. ¿Quién? Okay. Ben, por favor, Ben. You're just going to hold this. Yeah.
I will try to present in English. No.
Thank you.
Okay. All of we developed the validating of the spiritual health scale.
Nosotros hemos desarrollado una validación del crecimiento espiritual.
It's very important to.
La diapositiva es muy importante.
Yes. All right. Okay. Good. Hi, finally. All right. Okay. This scale started with the integrated health concept.
Vamos a empezar con el concepto de salud integral.
Spiritual health is one of the four dimensions of human health as defined by the World Health Organization.
La salud espiritual es una de las cuatro dimensiones de la salud humana, así como está definida por la Organización Mundial de Salud.
Along with the physical, social, and mental dimensions.
Junto con las dimensiones físicas, sociales, y mentales.
Spiritual health constitute one of the basic aspects of health.
La salud espiritual constituye una de las cuatro bases de la salud.
Okay. Do you know how our scale started?
¿Ustedes saben cómo nuestra escala comenzó?
Well, when Nutrinex, Mexico and France consortium request to Montemorelos University to develop a validated scale for spiritual health.
Bueno, la organización de Nutrinex, MXFR, en México, nos pidió que hiciéramos una escala validada con respecto a la salud espiritual.
Do you know why? Because they were reading books of Ellen G. White on nutrition and health. So a team of researchers from the University of Montemorelo was entrusted with the development of such scale. Spiritual nature is universal.
La naturaleza espiritual es universal.
Every human being has a spiritual dimension that moves to seek the transcendence of eternal.
Cada ser humano tiene una dimensión espiritual que nos mueve a buscar la trascendencia eterna.
See, this scale assumes that a spiritual dimension is unique. Different, but interrelated with the physical, mental, and social dimension of the human being. So we work developing a generic spiritual health scale which applies to every person of any ideology. That is the main issue, because it's not easy. It's not easy. So scales that strictly measure spiritual health are few. And mostly characterized by mental, emotional, or religious, rather than properly defined as spiritual. Other scales are specifically aimed The people with the specific health conditions, social context, etc. Addressed. Well, the spiritual health scale, Monte Morelos University, is not intended to provide an index of spiritual health. That allows identifying the most understanding fixture of convictions, perceptions, emotions, attitudes, and spiritual practices. Okay. So, our conceptual definition about spiritual health is a state of well-being in harmony with what is considered a sacred or superior with one's self, with his fellow man, or with nature. So it involves experiencing a transcendent sense of life and an ultimate purpose according to the belief system. So this scale is distinguished because it presents a profile that measures the degree to which the participant self-evaluates his conviction, emotion, attitudes, and practices consistent with the good, noble, right, or correct with respect to the sacred. Well, this was our timeline, yes. From 2017. And until now, because our scale is in progress. So, the technical specification of a preliminary instrument is present in this. With 822 subjects or participants. And factorial analysis was conducted with 39 items. Do you know what's very, very good, very good model, yes. All right. Three factors were found. Relationship with the Supreme Being and spiritual convictions. Relationship with others and with nature.
Nature.
And relationship with myself, with outer. Yes. By October 2018, through internet by Facebook. The instrument was administered to 3,514. So the results were very interesting. A confirmatory factor analysis was applied using a principal components method with Barimax rotation, orthogonal. So, 3 factors were identified, taking account only those items with a factorial load greater than 0.3. Communalities greater than 0.4. So this is the reliability, yes. Do you know? Yes. Do you know? It's very, very good internal consistency. But according to Kolmogorov Smirnov test, the variables are non-normal and with a negative skewness. It was decided not to classify group by means of percentiles. So in the near future, the committee formed by Charles Marcel, Health Department Associate of General Conference, Mrs. Belkis Archbold, Health Ministry Director of the Inter-American Division, Dr. Naun Garcia, Director of Health Science School at Montemorelos University, Dr. Roel Cia, Health Department Director, North Mexican Union, and the Technical Committee of Montemorelos University recommended to translate the scale into English and French to apply it territories of the Inter-American Division. Yes. And to apply a non-religious people. Thank you very much. Question?
I think you have to give another round of applause. The presentation was in English. Thank you very much. I'm so happy we decided to be on fasting today.
Estoy muy feliz que decidimos ayunar hoy.
So we just literally have 60 seconds for questions.
Bueno, realmente tenemos 60 segundos para preguntas.
Burning questions.
Rápidas, preguntas rápidas.
And we will have all 4 presenters, because we already fielded questions for Dengue, did we?
Yes.
Right. So, burning questions.
Queremos preguntas rápidas.
That you would not be able to sleep tonight.
Que no van a estar dispuestas a dormir esta noche.
Right. Do we have any questions?
¿Tenemos alguna pregunta?
Wonderful. Can I have all our presenters stand
favor,
so we can...
Todos los
show our appreciation. Thank you. Thank you. It is my understanding that we should make our way to the main campus. Yes, I don't see the bus, and therefore it is exercise time.
No, he visto el autobús, pero bueno,
tiempo with all the presenters can be.
Yes, yes. Where is she? The photographer. Presenters. Queremos sacar una foto.
Foto, foto.
Foto, presenters. All the presenters.